Thanks for tuning in. I'm going to be presenting to you a subject that came up in my theology class, which is, could Jesus have sinned? I want to start out by saying this is a lecture presentation for anyone. It doesn't matter who you are. As long as you've asked the question or even thought remotely about the fact of it, if Jesus really could have sinned. So what I'm going to do right now is outline where we're going to be going with this, kind of the flow of how this is going to go. So we're going to start out by reviewing Jesus's divinity as it is seen in Scripture. After that, we'll go into Jesus's humanity as seen in Scripture. Then we're going to go into Jesus's full humanity and his full divinity at the same time, and why it's important for Jesus to have been both fully human and fully divine. After that, we're going to go to the definition of sin and the definition of holiness. And after that, we'll go to, could Jesus have really have sinned, which is the main thesis for this paper. And then I'll be closing up with, what does that really mean for us, for humanity? So, I'm going to get right to it. We're going to go look at Jesus's divinity as seen in Scripture. So, right off the bat, in the Gospel of Matthew, this is actually addressed. In Matthew 1:20, it says, Joseph, son of David, this is an angel speaking to Joseph, by the way. So it says, Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. More support for this is found in Luke 1:34-35, who says this, and Mary said to the angel, how will this be, since I am a virgin? And the angel answered to her, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God. It's necessary to address this issue from Jesus' birth first in order to establish grounds for his divinity that is shown throughout the rest of Scripture. Scripture says that though Jesus was born of a human mother, it was from the Holy Spirit that Jesus was conceived. That's where he came from. Further confirmation of Jesus's divinity comes actually at the beginning, maybe a little bit before his ministry, specifically at his baptism. Both Matthew 3:17, actually, sorry, scratch the both. There's three scriptures I want to look at here. It'll be Matthew chapter 3, verse 17, Mark 1, verse 11, and Luke 3:22. They all record this event. Pretty much it goes through John baptizes Jesus, not the Apostle John, John the Baptist, baptizes Jesus. And at the end of all of this, there's a voice that comes from heaven, and it says, you are my beloved Son. With you I am well pleased. This phrase is heard again, worded a little bit differently, but it's about the same at the transfiguration account of Jesus, which is recorded in Matthew 17:1-8, Mark 9:2-8, and Luke 9:28-36. 36 would be the first segment because it goes on after that. In fact, the very event of transfiguration in Jesus' life is evidence for Jesus' divinity. And we have Moses and Elijah, two great prophets, coming to visit and give counsel to Jesus. I don't think that's something that happens normally to us. I mean, it's actually shown that in Scripture. I think it was Peter comes up to Jesus and he says, should I build three tents for up here, one for you and one for Moses and one for Elijah? And that signifies it's not just like something that happened just to Jesus. You know, Peter saw it with his own eyes and he was like, wow, there are two other dudes with Jesus. So that sums it up for Jesus' divinity as seen in Scripture. So now we're going to transition into Jesus' humanity as seen in Scripture. Again, both Matthew 1 and Luke 1 remark on Jesus' humanity. Matthew goes most in depth because he deals with the bloodline, the bloodline of King David, which Jesus is descended from. He's really, really concerned with that. While Luke kind of just stresses the means in which Jesus came, which is he came born from a woman, a virgin woman. Further proof of his humanity is he had brothers, he had sisters, and a loving mother. A good example of this would be the dedication that Mary had all the way up to and following Jesus' death on the cross. She hung around and wept and did everything else, which is, I think, Scripture doesn't really record much happening with the apostles at that time. Well, the disciples before they were apostles. Another would be the concern that both Mary and Joseph, Jesus' parents, the kind of concern they had for Jesus when he went missing, when he was a child, I think when he was 12 years old, his parents had thought that he was with them while they traveled away from Jerusalem, only to find out that he was missing. And they came back and they found him in the temple. They found Jesus in the temple talking with the rabbis. And they're like, "What are you doing here? You're supposed to be with us. We're worried sick about you," and everything like that. And he's like, "Well, this is where I belong," kind of thing. So he had caring parents, like just like you or me would have caring parents. So another proof of his humanity comes in the temptation account that he has with Satan. It says, before he wandered out into the desert, he actually had no food or no water. So by the time this actually happens, by the time the devil confronts Jesus, he had gone 40 days with no food and water, and it said, Scripture says that Jesus was hungry and he was tired. I would be pretty hungry and pretty tired if I hadn't had food even for a whole day. So I can kind of, but not really, relate with him on that. But the end line here is a supernatural being that was just in this world acting like us would not actually be affected by the lack of food or rest or any kind of nourishment. It just wouldn't happen. Like, this is Jesus being hungry, and actually the devil came at him after this 40 days because he knew this would be when Jesus was the weakest. He also expressed emotion in Matthew 26 when Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane. The expression that Jesus used before his betrayal, before he went and prayed before the Father about everything going on, he said to the disciples that he was sorrowful even to death. In our words today, it would be equivalent to, "Guys, I am scared to death right now. Like, I am truly scared." And that's what he was saying. I don't know if supernatural beings can feel that kind of emotion of being scared to death. In fact, he was so scared that Scripture says his sweat turned into blood, which is an actual real medical condition called, forgive me, this might be horrible, but hematohidrosis, where there's so much stress and high tension in someone's body that their sweat actually turns into a bloody substance. Another incident that proves Jesus's humanity is he actually felt real sadness, real human, raw emotion at the death of Lazarus, a lot of people joke about how, maybe not joke about, but remark on the fact that the shortest verse in the entire Bible is Jesus wept. And that was when he found out Lazarus was dead. Other accounts, such as when Jesus ran into the temple and turned the tables over that the money exchangers were on, selling their sacrifices and stuff, that, like, he was angry. And then other times when he gets genuinely frustrated with the disciples when they just don't understand what he's talking about, or when they have they show severe lack of faith in him. So, you know, sometimes he'll come out with these small outbursts, like, how much longer must I be with you? So that sums up Jesus's humanity as seen in Scripture. So Scripture shows that Jesus was divine. He's the Son of God. And it's mentioned several times that Jesus is the Son of God. He was born of the Holy Spirit through a virgin woman. It's also, I'm going to get to this a little bit later, but he is called the Son of Man, which has some huge, huge divinity implications. And we're actually, I think I'm getting into that right now, which is Jesus's full divinity and full humanity at the same time. I think perhaps Philippians 2 verses 5 through 11 it does the best job of explaining this. And here I'll read it. It reads, and this is Paul talking to the church in Philippi, and it says this: Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. And being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, or even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under earth, and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Elaborating on this and kind of supporting this for the people who enjoy seeing Old Testament and New Testament working together hand in hand, we see further proof of Jesus's humanity and divinity actually in the book of Daniel chapter 7. It says an excellent job of this, and this ties into the Son of Man here. So it says, I saw in the night visions, and behold, with the clouds of heaven there came one like a Son of Man, and he came to the Ancient of Days, and was presented before him, and to him was given dominion and glory and a kingdom, that all peoples, nations, and languages, see the parallel there, should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion, which shall not pass away, and his kingdom one that shall not be destroyed. As I mentioned earlier, Jesus is often referred to in the New Testament as the Son of Man, and this Daniel 7 is actually a huge place where we find support of what the Son of Man actually is. In fact, Jesus, or the Son of Man, is used 83 times in the New Testament, and all of the Son of Man references refer to Jesus in some way. If Jesus really is the Son of Man, as presented in Daniel 7, it means that somehow, some way, shape, or form, he actually enters into the presence of God. That feat alone means that he, who is the Son of Man, born into this world as a man, somehow transcends our world into the spiritual world. And to do that, he must be blameless in the sight of God. He has to be divine. God in Daniel 7 is the Ancient of Days. So what I want you guys to notice here is in both Daniel 7 and in Philippians 2, Jesus isn't portrayed as God, but rather as God's equal. See, the word used for grasped in Philippians 2:6 is a word that describes something kind of like a prize to be seized. It's something that is something to be prideful about. And this means that though Jesus knew full well that he was equal to God, This means that Jesus was equal to God. He had the same authority, the same power as God, but he chose not to use it. But it is saying Jesus was fully human and fully divine at the same time. The honor that Jesus is given in the end of Philippians 2 and in Daniel 7, this is an honor of God. This is the honor that is bestowed, that is reserved, the glory that is reserved for God is bestowed on Jesus Christ, who is a man. It is saying Jesus is fully man, fully divine. This is all because of God's will. So, now that we have that all out of the way, before answering the question of if Jesus really could have sinned or not, we have to address the actual definitions of sin and of holiness. So, we'll start with the definition of sin first. A brief summary of this is, sin is a disobedience to God, whether knowing or unknowing. This disobedience leads to a status of unholiness or uncleanliness, which prevents the person from entering into God's presence. Because since God is the epitome of holiness, he can't be in the same place as unholiness and holiness. That's just not how it works. So now that we're talking about holiness, this is the definition of holiness. To be holy is to not only be sinless, but to live a life that is in every bit in line with God's commandments. It goes beyond not sinning to just the point of perfect obedience. Philippians 2 said that Jesus' obedience was perfect, even to the point of dying on a cross, which was shameful. It was the worst kind of death imaginable at the time that Jesus lived on the earth. In John's revelation, we see Jesus as being worshipped in extreme reverence. In fact, in Revelation, he is described as the only one who was holy enough, who was worthy enough to open the scroll with seven seals on it that nobody else could open. And, that section of scripture ends with all the angels and all the elders in heaven bowing down and saying, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing." They're saying, look, Jesus, who is the Lamb who was slain, he is holy enough to have attained all of this. So, now that we have all of that out of the way, the issue, the question that we have been building up to is this: could Jesus, in his full humanity and full divinity, could he actually have sinned? I believe, and this is just me through my research in Scripture and other places, I believe that the answer to this question is yes. Yes, I believe that Jesus was capable of sinning. It could have happened. I believe this because it was to provide the perfect sacrifice that was necessary for the atonement of all of humanity's sins, past, present, and future. But just because I think it is possible for Jesus to have sinned, I don't think that the reality of if Jesus could have sinned is actually a real thing. I don't think it was actually quite so possible. He knew that the role that he had, he knew the role that he had to play. And he also had the assurance of who he is, especially when God confirmed him as his son, as we talked about earlier, in Matthew 3:17, and also in the Luke passage I mentioned earlier, when after Jesus was baptized, they heard a loud voice from heaven saying, "This is my son with whom I am well pleased." I would actually say that Jesus' calling to his ministry was really not unlike any of the prophets' callings. They had the choice to disobey God if they had really wanted to. They could have said no, but the odds of that actually happening at that point in their lives was so slim to none that it looked as if it was actually impossible for them to say no, for them to disobey. I'm saying that they could have said no, but they didn't, because at that exact point, at their calling, God had prepared them for their ministries with the way they had been brought up, with the families they were in, with the people they had been around, all the experiences in their lives. At that point, when God said, "Come follow me, this is what I have planned out for you, this is what I want you to do," they could have said no, but they were so well prepared and they knew it that they could not have said no, because it would have made no sense. It just would have made no sense whatsoever. And I think they also were a little wary of the whole situation of saying no because of events like Jonah, where he said no, and God was like, "Well, you said no, but I've prepared you. You're the one I want to do this. You're the person I want you to do to save, bring Nineveh to repentance. So you're going to run away, and I'm going to make sure you get there anyway." So, looking back on all the examples they had in Scripture, looking back on their lives, their training, their preparation, it just didn't seem really reasonable, logical for them to say no. I think Jesus was the same way. By the time he realized, like, this is what I have to do, by the time he was like, "Okay, I am the Messiah, okay, I am the Son of God," he was prepared for it beyond belief. Support for this, for if Jesus really could have sinned, I posit to you from Hebrews 4:15 and onward, it says this: "For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted just as we are, yet is without sin." The fact that we actually have, that the word temptation is used to describe something that happened to Jesus, that something that he experienced temptation just like you or me, to say that means that Jesus, in fact, could have sinned if he chose to. He was tempted. Temptation doesn't happen if there is no possibility of a sin. In Luke 4, when Jesus was tempted by Satan to use his divine powers to make life easier for himself, we like to, when Satan says, "Hey, you're hungry, make some food," when he brings Jesus up to the top of the city, or the tallest tower in the city, and says, "Jump and let your angels catch you," and when he brings them up to the mountain, he says, "Hey, look, this, you can have all the riches in these lands." Those were all very real to Jesus. And if Jesus had done any of these, and this right here was the plan of Satan the whole time, if Jesus had done any of those things, if he had given in and just said, "You know what, I really am hungry, let me turn one of these rocks into bread for me to eat," if he had done any of those, he would have been living his life in disobedience with God's will, which is what sin is. Because even though he was divine, even though he had the power to do that, God didn't want that to happen. See, God sent his son into the world as a man, to live as a man, to die as a man, for the salvation of mankind. And using his divine powers to make life easier for him, to make his ministry easier for him, would have crushed everything. It would have destroyed the model that Christians have to look after, to look up to when they're living their lives. And see, this Jesus's resistance to temptation gives a huge, huge, huge thought, a huge impact in my faith. Something that just I hold very dear to me, and it's this. Jesus denied himself of the very things that I struggle with. He denied himself everything that I struggle with, so that you can make it to have eternal life in the presence of God instead of in eternity in hell. I think the reason that the writer of Hebrews said that Jesus was tempted as we are is because Jesus is, because all those temptations were an appeal to Jesus' human nature. The Apostle Paul in the book of Galatians named some of these. This is not an exhaustive list at all. It actually, Paul kind of ends all of this with and things like these. So Galatians 5 labels it as sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things like these. He's saying, look, guys, the list could go on and on and on and on and on and on, but the bottom line is, Jesus was tempted and appealed to his humanity. I think the biggest difference, though, between Jesus and humanity would be the fact that though he was faced with the temptation to give in to his human nature, he resisted it as the Son of God through the Holy Spirit. It's hand in hand with the Holy Spirit. And the Spirit acted as an aid. This happened so that God would be glorified through the perfect sacrifice of his Son. Sorry, that sounded weird. This happened so that God would be glorified through the perfect sacrifice of his Son. The possibility that Jesus could have sinned adds value and incredible force behind his sinless nature. It's to provide a perfectly sufficient offering to God as a propitiation sacrifice. See, our sin, humanity's sin of past, present, and future, required something of infinite value. It would not do for us, for God to have just had human sacrifice cover human sacrifice, because a human and a human are equal. We need someone more. We need something more. God needed something more to atone for the sin. And to do that, he needed a divine value, an eternal value to cover an eternity's worth of sin. In the Old Testament, only a perfect sacrifice was acceptable to God, one that was without blemish. Humanly speaking, this means that in order for the most perfect sacrifice to happen, a perfectly sinless offering must be made. Jesus was that very offering. Remember, Hebrews 4:15 says this, "For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weakness, but one who in every aspect, or who in every respect has been tempted as we are. Yet, even though he has been tempted, yet he is without sin." So he experienced the temptation. He understands it. He knows it fully, just like you or I do. But he did not sin. He is the flawless sacrifice, the perfectly sinless human with the divine value that is required. The stage is set. So, now that we understand Jesus's divinity, his humanity, his full divinity and humanity at the same time, and we know the definitions of sin and holiness, and we've dealt with could Jesus have sinned? And the answer is yes, it's very possible that he could have, though it's not very likely. What does that mean for humanity? What does that mean for you and for me? I believe that the fact that Jesus could have sinned, but he did not sin, is an incredible source of hope for us, because God has brilliantly provided hope for us through the model of Jesus Christ. Notice what I said a little bit ago. Jesus resisted sin, resisted temptation as the Son of God with the Holy Spirit as an aid. See, that's the key there. I also mentioned it back in Hebrews, which attested to Jesus, to the fact that Jesus actually knows, and maybe he even wrestled. Maybe he didn't really wrestle with these sins. Maybe it wasn't just like something where it's like, oh, wow, I'm really feeling my humanity tugging at me, but the Holy Spirit intervened and was like, hey, look, this is your task. Brought maybe some scripture into his mind or something like that. Maybe he actually even struggled. Maybe there was something that came up that just constantly tempted him. Who's to know? That's an interesting thought. Jesus actually knows, and maybe he even wrestled with every temptation that we have experienced. Christians, believers, followers of Christ, whatever you want to call them, they're always called to strive to be more Christ-like. At first glance, that kind of seems unfair, because we've already talked about, Jesus is fully human, yeah, but he's also fully divine. He's the Son of God, so of course he could resist sin. He had the Holy Spirit on him from the day one of his ministry. He had the Holy Spirit just completely guiding him through the whole thing. So it seems a bit impossible for us to be Christ-like. It seems kind of unfair to say that. But it's really not impossible. And it's really not unfair. You see, Jesus wrestled with temptation and sin just like us. Just like you or I. But he didn't resist it based on his divinity. He resisted it as a human with the Holy Spirit as an aid. You see, that was Jesus' secret. That's how it happened. That's how Scripture portrays it. That even if he were to sin, even if he were to feel weak in the flesh, the Spirit would carry him through. So this part is free. I kind of left this out on purpose. So this is the application part of it. And if you are kind of not interested in hearing the application part, then I guess if you really wanted to, you could go ahead and stop listening or whatever you want to do. But I really hope that you will just sit back and listen. Just take this in. You don't have to agree with me. I hope you know you don't have to agree with me with anything I've said. I just want you to kind of think for yourself about everything that I presented for you. And this is the application of this whole thing. And I really want you guys to home in on this. So how does the fact that Jesus could have sinned apply to us? How does this all work into the Christian faith? How does this work into maybe someone who's dealing with Christianity and they don't understand how people can overcome sin? Maybe this is an answer for someone who doesn't believe in God or who doesn't like Christians at all because of their hypocrisy or something. Just think about this for a second. I'm going to say some stuff and just think about it. Just absorb it. On the day of Pentecost, Peter stood before thousands of people and delivered one of the most hopeful, I admit, is appropriately probably one of the most quoted scriptures or messages in the faith, in the history of the Christian faith. And it's in Acts 2. I'm going to start actually at Acts 2, verses 36 through 40. And just listen here. Therefore, let all of Israel be assured of this. God made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah. When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, Brothers, what shall we do? And Peter replied to them, he said this, Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins. And you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. This promise is for you. And it's for your children, and it's for all of those who are far off. It is for all whom the Lord our God will call. With many other words, he warned them, and he pleaded with them, Save yourselves from this corrupt generation. See, the model of Christ and his application to our lives, its application to our lives, is that though Jesus was fully human, just like you or me, we are fully human beings, he resisted sin and temptation, not as a divine being, but he resisted it as a human being with the assistance of the Holy Spirit. How does this work for us? On the day of Pentecost, God made it possible for us for humanity to do the same exact thing and resist sin with the aid of the Holy Spirit. Guys, look back at Acts 2:38. I'm going to go back and read it for you guys. I don't want you to miss it because this is what the whole message has been leading up to, is this. It is not a hopeless endeavor. It is not hopeless to try to be Christ-like. God has set the stage for you and for me and for everyone else in humanity. As long as they take Christ into their lives, as long as they are baptized into his name, they repent, we can all resist sin the same way that Jesus did. Let me just read this back over again. Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. This is huge. Forgiveness of all your sins. It does, past, present, and future. See, Jesus' death was for you, for me, for everybody, past, present, future. That is the eternal value of Christ's sacrifice. And this is what I want you guys to hear right here is, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. That's it. How is it possible for you to resist sin as a human just like Jesus did? How is it possible? It's as simple as repenting and as being baptized. And God has promised. This scripture says this is a promise. God does not take his promises lightly. It is for you. And it is for your children. And it is for everyone who is far off. That is the hope. That is the model that Jesus Christ gave to us. So in closing, yes, I do believe, I firmly believe Jesus very well could have sinned if he chose to, but I don't think it was very likely at all, because he was the model that God chose for the rest of his followers, for humanity to follow, to look up to. It would not have made sense for God to say, look at this person who is the epitome of perfect, but he sinned. It just wouldn't have made sense. But it does make sense to say, look at this person. He was a person. Yes, he was my son, but that was to save you. I want you to look at his model. He could have sinned just like you, just like me. He could have sinned like all of us, but he chose not to. God's saying, look to this man who did not resist sin and temptation as a divine being, as part of the Godhead. He resisted sin as a human with the same spirit that can reside in me and in you, as long as we just believe and we are baptized and we truly repent and follow Jesus Christ. That's a promise to us all. So, thank you very much for listening. I was actually really excited about this paper. So, thank you again for listening. I would really appreciate it if you gave me some sort of feedback. I'm not sure yet if I'm going to enable comments on this video or not. But I will, however, put an email address in the, not the comment section, the description section below, so you guys can email me if I don't have the comments enabled. So thank you again for listening. I would really love to hear your feedback, your input on what I've talked about. So God bless.